Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Math Homework Hotline. I'm Tammy Derry.
And I'm Hanna.
And we are so glad you're watching our show because our show is for you. It's designed just for you to help you with your math homework. So we encourage you tonight to get those math questions ready and keep our teachers busy. They are already on the phones waiting for your calls. Our phone number is along the bottom of your screen. There it is, 813-840-7260. So go ahead and give us a call. You can call in with any topic tonight that you're working on, and they'll be happy to help you. Don't forget, we're also streaming live, so if you happen to be away from your television, go ahead and take that tablet or phone with you, and you can find us at mhh.mysdhc.org. And speaking of calling in with any topic, you sure can. Go ahead and make that phone call and get some help. But while we're waiting for your phone calls, we have a specific topic that we're going to focus on tonight, and let's see what it is. Tonight's topic is really a combined topic. We're going to look at a couple different things. We're going to talk about exponents and measures of centers. So when we talk about rules for exponents, we'll be focusing in that area. And then you'll see Hanna and I do some questions related to mean, median, and mean absolute deviation. So we're going to be taking a look at some really good topics because at this time of the year, we thought it would be appropriate to make sure we got both of those in before the semester ends. So great topics planned for tonight. I can't wait to get to my math problems. And speaking of math problems, you know, Hanna always has a special challenge question every week. And this time, I think he's outdone himself. I've said that before, but I think this time you may have, Hanna.
I sure did. I think I did. And that going, you know, over or beyond the limit with the effort I put with this question made me doubt whether we would get a winner or not. But I want you to prove that my doubt is wrong. I want you to prove that we would have a winner, and that winner could be you. Let's take a look first at the challenge question and see how you judge it and how you like it. And if you do like it, please give it a shot and try, and you may end being our winner for tonight. Let's first take a look at it. Yeah. Read it to yourself as I read it out loud to you and take a picture of it. Yes, this needs to be taken a picture of. It reads, calculate the value of the quantity. And the quantity is not hard to do. It's just put in a new exponential format. I put the quantity, 25% of 40, all to the power quantity, 10% of 30. Let me read it one more time. It's quantity to the power of another quantity. The base is basically quantity, 25% of 40, all. The power or the exponent is quantity, 10% of 30, all. Work it, find the result, give us a call, and we'll find out who's going to be the winner. The first winner, the first caller with the right answer would be announced as our challenge question winner. And that could be you. Give it a shot. You can do it. I believe you can do it. Okay? It's not that hard. Back to you, Tammy.
All right. Thanks, Hanna. We're going to go ahead and get started in just a minute, but I want to remind you, if you call in tonight, you could be the winner of one of our Do the Math t-shirts. Don't forget that we give those away throughout the show. I know. And look, the back has our Math Homework Hotline logo on it. Here we go, right there. So if you call in tonight and you have a real math question and you talk to one of our math teachers, your name will go into a drawing for you to possibly win one of our Math Homework Hotline t-shirts. And I hope you do call in and win one. That'll be exciting. Also, I really hope we get a challenge question winner. All you have to do is work that problem out and give us a call and tell the teacher that answers the phone that you've got the challenge question, and they'll get that information to us. Can't wait. Speaking of can't wait, let's do some math. There we go. This particular problem is going to focus on the topic tonight that we're looking at related to the mean. So what we're going to do is we're going to think about a bookstore that might be selling books, maybe on a college university or maybe just in a local mall. And the book sales for each day of the week during the weekday are listed. So we might think it might be, you know, maybe at a little college or something, and they're selling some books and they want to see what is the mean or the average number of books that are sold per day at the bookstore. So what would be the average? So if somebody walked in and said, how about how many books do you sell each particular day, they would have that estimate. So what we're going to do is to find the mean. Let's go ahead and put a couple of notes here for those of you that are watching. The mean is another word for finding the average. An average is going to be just like some of you in class, maybe you're asked by your teachers to add up your grades and divide by how many you have to get the average. That's what the average is. So the first step in finding the average is that you have to find the sum of all of the data points that you're looking at. So in our case, we're looking at Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. So we would find the sum of those values. So to do that, we would add all of our numbers up, and you can, you know, in this case, you may be able to grab a calculator depending on what grade level you're in. On some of our standardized tests, sixth graders don't use one. But if you were to do the sum, you could actually go ahead and you could, if you had to write them without a calculator, you certainly could write them up in a column and go ahead and add them up. So the sum of this total comes up to be 515. So when I add 105, 96, 90, 108, and 116, I get 515. So I find the sum. That's not the average. So if you look up here, if I said I sold 515 books every day, that would be way off. So first thing you do is you find the sum, but then the second thing you do is you're going to divide by how many entries you have, or the number of days of the week in this case. So you're going to do your division, and we're going to do that step by counting up how many days we had in our data. So in this case, I've got a nice little chart here. It's easy to see that it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But maybe if you're doing lots of data points, you may want to go back and make sure you didn't miss any. So we're going to divide this number, 515, by 5. And when we do that, in this case, you wouldn't really need a calculator. This is a great mental math question. So we're going to go 5 goes into 5 one time. And then if you're still working on your division, you might have to do your 1 times 5 and subtract. Or if you're ready to move on, you could say, well, I know 5 won't go into 1, so that would be a 0. And then 5 would go into 5, 15, because you would pull that that 1 over there, and it would be a 3. If you needed to work it out the long way, that's always a possibility. If you don't have a calculator, it's certainly okay to take a quick moment and go, okay, that didn't go in there, so I'm going to subtract that 0, and I've got that 15, and that's where that 3 came from. So wherever you are in your math, I know a lot of our students that watch are in elementary school, and so you might still be working it right here, and that's certainly fine. We want you to grow and love mathematics by watching Math Homework Hotline. So if I were to answer the question that I asked you at the beginning, what is the mean number of books sold per day at this particular bookstore, you would now be able to say about 103, or you could even probably even estimate and say about 100 a day, but 103 would be our answer for this one. So good stuff. Love math, Hannah.
I do too.
Fun.
I love math.
Love it.
Yes, and especially when we connect it to real life, like mm-hmm. this example. Here's another example that matches very much what Tammy just covered, except we're going to add a little piece to it. This time, the mean is not just the mean, as she explained, but it's the mean absolute deviation, which we have abbreviation for as MAD, M-A-D, mean absolute deviation. Watch carefully is how we figure this. We have to go through the mean first. The mean is the same process as Tammy just covered. We're going to add those 5 items and divide by 5. As simple as that. So we're going to say, okay, 22 plus 23 plus 31 plus 17 plus 42 would equal, we can add it together, 2 plus 3 is 5, 6 plus 7 is 13, plus 2 is 15, 5 and carry 1, plus 2 is 3, plus 2 is 5, plus 3 is 8, 1 is 9, plus 4 is 13. So the sum of all 5 items is 135. Whether these are books to be sold per day and then we're figuring out the average, or say scores on your tests and you wanted to figure out the average, whatever those stand for, but we would have to go through the process of finding the mean. So by taking the 135, dividing this by 5, 5 goes into 13 2 times, 5 goes into 1, of course, 0 times, then you take the 1 and the 3 together, 5 goes into 13, 2 times 5 is 10, subtracting from 13, you get 3. Then you bring down the 5, and then you say 5 goes into 35 7 times. So now times 7 by 5, you get 35. Subtract, you get 0, 0. So now our mean equals 27. But this is not our MAD. No, not yet. To figure out the MAD, the mean absolute deviation, you do this. Watch. Big fraction bar. We're going to do how far or how close this first piece of information, this piece of data deviates from the mean guy. All right? That is 22, subtract the mean and put the absolute value. That's why we call it absolute deviation. So how far is it from the mean, or how close is it to the mean? That would be determined with by the subtraction, finding the difference. And because we're not to deal with differences in negatives, we're going to put the absolute value. That's why we call it absolute deviation. We're going to do the same process 5 times. For absolute value of 23 minus the mean plus the absolute value of the 31 minus the mean plus absolute value of 17 minus the mean plus the last one, which is 42 minus the mean. Again, absolute value. So don't forget, step one is to find the real mean, as Tammy just showed us, by adding, dividing by how many they are. Got the mean, 27. Then subtract the mean from every data, the mean, that's 22 minus 27, 23 minus 27, 31 minus 27, 17 minus 27, 42 minus 27. Always put those differences in absolute values, all the way. That's why we call it absolute. Now we're going to divide by how many absolute values we got, and that is 5 also. Let's do it together. Now, 22 minus 27 is negative 5, but look, when you get the absolute value, is positive 5 plus. 23 minus 27 is negative 4, with the absolute value of negative 4 is 4, plus 31 minus 27 is also 4, whose absolute value is 4, plus 17 minus 27 is negative 10, whose absolute value is 10, that's positive 10, the OCD part of me has to act always. Plus, now that 42 minus the 27 is negative, no, it's positive 15, and the absolute value of 15 is 15. And this is a good review on the absolute value. And the absolute value would always take the number inside it and turn into either zero or positive, but not negative, never negative. And you divide this whole summation by how many they are, and that is 5 again. Continue the process. Everybody, add with me. 5 plus 4 is 9, plus 4 is 13. 13 plus 10 is 23. 23 plus 15 is 38. And divide that by 5. And when you divide 38 by 5, you wonder if you need a calculator for this or not. Here's a good technique that you do not need a calculator for this division. You can basically do this. You can divide 3 by 5, it would not work. 38 divides by 5 7 times. 7 times 5 is 35. From 38, you get 3 remaining, and that's 3 fifths, which is 7 point, you know how 3 fifths is, you multiply by 2 here, and you multiply by 2 here, you get 6 tenths, and that is 7.6 then. So instead of writing it as 38 fifths, which is, in my view, is okay to end your answer with, or you want to make it a mixed number, you divide, you get 7 and 3 fifths. You multiply that fraction, 3 fifths, by 2 by 2 to get 10 in the denominator, so you can convert it easily into a decimal number. And that's 7 and 6 tenths, which is 7.6. 7.6, everybody, is our MED, which is the mean absolute deviation. Hope you enjoyed this. Hope you learned it. If you did, tell other people about how you can explain it to them, explain it to other people and help them out if they don't know how to get it. And tell them where you watched it and where you understood it on Math Homework Online. All right, back to you, Tammy.
All right, thanks, Hanna. We're gonna go ahead and take a look at another one of the words that was in our actual topics at the top of the show, mm-hmm. and we're gonna look at the median. So we're gonna have covered all three of those in just the first part of our show. So let's take a look at my board, and I have two different sets of numbers. So we're gonna focus on the top set, and we're gonna understand the idea behind the median. The median is another data point, and it's the number that falls exactly in the middle when the data is placed in order from least to greatest. And technically, it could be in order from greatest to least, as long as they are in order, but we usually always go least to greatest just because it's easier for us to make sure we have all our numbers. So the key thing in here is we're gonna make sure that we order them from least to greatest. And while we're doing that, we're also making sure that we're catching all of those numbers. So when I do this, this is one of the strategies I use, is I know I've got to put them in order from least to greatest, and the median is the number that is going to represent the middle number of the set of data. And the way you can remember that is if you're driving down the road, there's usually on a larger road, like an interstate, there's always a grassy area between the two sets of lanes. That in real world is called the median. So when you're driving, or you learn to drive if you're not already, you'll learn that the median is in the middle of those two fast moving lanes, and hence the middle number in math is going to be called the median. It's kind of a neat way to make that connection. So we're going to look at this top list of numbers first, and we're going to start with the smallest number, which is 2. So as I write the number, I'm also going to make just a little line through it, just so I can still see it, but I know that I've already gotten that one. Because I have to go from least to greatest, I'm then gonna find the 4. And this is where it gets tricky, because I started to grab the 7, but I see a 6 sitting there in the middle, so let me get that one. And then the 7. And then the 8. And then 11. And then the 15. And now I've got all of my numbers listed. So now what I need to do is figure out what number is in the middle. So there's, again, a couple of strategies you can use. I'm gonna switch colors for just a minute for you watching at home. I'm gonna grab green. So if I kind of imagine that if I'm gonna work my way to the middle, I wanna take the least number and the greatest number, go back and forth until I get to that middle. So if I imagine I did those, these, and then look what happens. A number will end up in the middle of this list. The reason that a number ends up in the middle on this list is because I have an odd number of entries. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 entries. So when I see that I have an odd number, I know I'm going to end up with a median that's going to land right in the middle. Because see, I have 3 on each side, and that 7th number is that middle number. So in this case, the median, or the middle number of this list of data, is going to be 7. So that one works out really nicely. The number comes up in the middle, you put them in order, looks good. Let's talk about what happens now when I have an even number. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 is an even number. I still have to follow my steps. I'm looking for the middle number, so I'm gonna put them in order from least to greatest. So let's do that. Let's go back to our black marker. So we're following the same setup. We're gonna grab that smallest number, happens to be a 2 in this list as well. And I almost did it. I saw the 3 out of the corner of my eye over here. Come back. 3, 4, 8, 10, and 11. So now I have all of them. So I want to make sure that I double check. I've got all of them. I need 6. I have 6. And then we start the process again. Switching back to my green marker, I'm going to go ahead and go, okay, smallest and greatest. Next one. Uh-oh. I have 2. So it's not as easy as this one. It's not just sitting right there. Not hard, we can fix this. So we have 2 numbers that are sitting in the middle. So the process we use when this happens, because they're not always as neat and tidy as these are, because I could probably tell you the middle number in my head by looking at where they sit, but the process we use is to actually find the average, which we just did at the beginning of the show, of those 2 numbers to find out what number is in the middle. So we would take the 8, and the 4 and add them together and divide by 2 because there's 2 entries. So we would have 8 plus 4 is 12 divided by 2, which is going to give us 6. So the median for this particular list of data would equal 6. So that sounds pretty good. Now I'm going to show you a mental math way to take a look at this before I pass it back to Hanna. So if you think about the numbers that are in here, it would be 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and I'm just going to mentally put them down here because this is what you might think in your head. And if you think about that when you look at them, what number sitting exactly in the middle between, whole number, between 4 and 8 is the number 6. So I could have actually taken a look or thought through that and figured out what that number was going to be. But if you want to make sure you've got it, go ahead and add those two center numbers and divide by 2 and you'll get the median. Two different problems, same process to find the median. You put them in order from least to greatest and then take a look at that middle number. Whether it's sitting there or you have to do a little bit to it, you'll get the median. All right, Hanna.
True, Tammy, they say live and learn. Mm-hmm. I just learned this technique from you. Listing of 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, I haven't done before and I haven't seen before.
Oh.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Yes.
I like that.
Very good.
Good. Well, Tammy, we're going to explain to our friends watching, what's the purpose of this? Why are we learning mean or median or mean absolute deviation? The purpose is this. If I am comparing two groups of student scores or two groups of salaries of some employees in two different companies or three different companies, to compare those groups, I have to get to what we call measure center or center of measurement. The center of measurement would be one of those that we're covering with you, like the mean is one. We can add those scores for this class and the other scores for the other class, get the mean here, get the mean here, and then compare this mean to that mean to tell basically which class average is higher, which class performs higher, and so forth. And if you have that information, you can go to the lower performing class and do some assistance, provide some tutoring, provide some after school help here or help there, some peer tutoring, and so forth. You see? So the purpose here. Maybe you're comparing two companies' salaries, so you can judge or make your decision which one to apply for. Maybe you're focusing on the salary as a determination key for your job application or for job search or job hunt. You want to see which company usually pays more, so you want to compare the salaries here versus the salaries here. You cannot really go through every one employee's salary and compare it to everyone's employee's salary. It would be very hard to do. But if you got the average in this company and the average in the other company, that can help you in your job research or job search or job hunt for which one company pays its employees better. So that's the purpose of what we're trying to do. Today we're going to also cover another topic with those measurement centers, and that is none other than exponents. And exponents are simple. I live it every single day. You say, how do you live exponents every single day? I say, yes. Years ago, there was a math supervisor before Tammy took over. Her name was Janet Boatman. At that time, I received a letter from her regarding some, you know, math league issues and stuff. And on that letter, she wrote this. She wrote, addressed it to Hanna Squared. It didn't really hit me before that letter came to me that my name is Hanna, and Janet wrote it as Hanna Squared. It was very neat. I liked it. And from that moment, I use it to explain exponents to my students. That Hanna power 2 or Hanna Squared, and many people call me Hanna Squared, by the way, just for you to know. Hanna, it's like X is X squared. A is A squared. So Hanna would be Hanna Squared. I appreciate, of course, Janet for sending me this letter with this kind of name on it. It really caused me a lot of fun everywhere I go. people call me Hanna squared, and we have a laughter, you know, according to this. Exponents, everybody. What is happening here with the exponents? This Hanna has a power 1. This other Hanna has a power 1. So when we multiply Hanna by Hanna, Hanna as a base, Hanna as a base, we take this base once, and we add the two exponents, 1 plus 1 equal 2. You see? By the way, even the same thing for x and x. X here has a power 1. Power 1, x, which is the base, is written once. And then we add the two powers, 1 and 1, add up to 2. For every a, there is a power 1. We don't always write it, but we know it is there. It exists. Not only power 1, but also a coefficient of 1. Learn this word, coefficient, if you don't know it yet. 1 as a coefficient and 1 as an exponent. If I'm adding a plus a, then I remind myself that this is 1a plus 1a, this is 2a. If I'm multiplying a by a, then I remind myself that this is a to the power 1, this is a to the power 1, you get a to the power 1 plus 1 equal 2. And this is the rule in exponents world, as when you have the two bases the same, you write the base once and you add the exponent. Now, what about then if I have a to the power 3 times a to the power 5? Then this would be a to the power 3 plus 5 equal 8. Now, that's multiplying. What if I'm dividing? What if I'm dividing a to the power 5 by a to the power 3? Well, division is the inverse operation of timesing. Addition is the inverse operation of subtraction, or subtraction is the inverse operation of addition. In multiplication, I added the exponents. In division, I subtract the exponents. So that would be a to the power 5, take away 3, which is 2, a squared. What if I have a to the power 2 all raised to the power 3? You multiply the inner power by the outer power, and you get a to the power 6. What if I have a to the power 2 times b to the power 3 times a to the power 4 times b to the power 5? Then you gather the bases that have the same, the amounts that have the same base, that is a. You take those two together, multiply them together according to the same rule like this one. And you add the 2 and the 4, you write the base A once, and you add the 2 and 4, you get 6, times the B to the power 3 and the B to the power 5 to get together, multiply together. You write this base once, and you add 3 and 5, you get 8. And so on. I do not want to take more time. We can have more examples as Tammy has some to do, and then we get back again. We alternate, as you all know. We have to share. Yes, Tammy, it's all yours.
Well, I have the opportunity now to give away some t-shirts, so this is going to be fun. Before we get to my math problem, I want to give away, it looks like three. I'm giving away three t-shirts. Must be having some good phone calls tonight. So here's our Math Homework Hotline logo, and don't forget it says do the math on the front, which is what we do here on our show, is we do the math. So we are going to give away three shirts right now. The first one is going to go out to Liberty Middle School to Sarat. So congratulations. That applause is for you. And just so you know, it will come to your math teacher in our school mail. So you want to let your math teacher know that you've won a t-shirt if you're still watching, Sarat, and they'll give it to you. It'll take a couple of days. That goes for everybody. It's going to win. Here we go. Out to Mulrennan is going a t-shirt to Alexander. Congratulations. You do the math shirt. Going out to Mulrennan. And going to Barrington. We have a shirt going out to Barrington. Are we ready? Jai, congratulations. This one is for you. They will be headed out to your math teacher, so in the next couple of days, keep your eyes out for them so that you can get your Math Homework Hotline t-shirt. Very fun. Hopefully we'll be able to give away some more before the end of the show, so keep calling in with those great math questions. Don't forget to, our teachers are ready and waiting for your phone calls. All right, let's take a look at what I have related to exponents. We have a couple of problems that I'm gonna look at, and I'm gonna go into kind of a little explanation to explain how Hanna was so quickly being able to get those numbers. So let's take a look at this. We have a to the fourth power times a to the third power. So first of all, we want to kind of think about what that means. Like Hanna explained, his name is Hanna. Hanna, how neat is that to have a squared name as a math teacher? That's awesome. Well, when we look at a to the fourth, what we're really seeing, if I'm thinking about this a is the base, this four is the exponent. So we got to get our vocabulary here. So we have our four and we have, that is the exponent. And then the a is called the base. So the exponent tells the base how many times it's going to be repeated. So if I'm focusing on this as blue, this would be a times a times a times a. So there's four a's. And then when I look at the three, remember with the a over here, this three is telling the a how many times are you going to be multiplied together? Three times. So now you can see this expanded out what we are doing. So when I look at this, I can now count how many A's I have multiplied together. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which is going to give me my answer of I have A to the 7th. But how do I get that? Well, this was A to the 4th, and this was A to the 3rd. And when you're multiplying with the same base, you're going to add those exponents. So we got the 7 by saying, knowing these are multiplied, it's the same as a to the fourth plus 3. So I'm gonna add those exponents, just like Hannah showed in his example at the top of this section of our show, and that a to the fourth plus 3 is a to the seventh. So the reason that we have these rules in math is because, I don't know about you, but I don't think I would want every time I saw this to have to write a times a times a times a, then do the next one, and then count them all up. So in math, we come up with these rules that allow us to do the math steps really quickly. That's why learning the rules is very helpful. So now when I get to this problem, I don't think I want to write all of those X's out all the way across my board. I want to use the rule. So I first checked and I say, do I have the same base? That's extremely important. When I walk around in classrooms, sometimes I'll see students try to put things together or multiply or whatever, and they're not the same. So when I'm looking at this, I know I've got x to the 6th and x to the 7th, so I'm like, okay, that's good. So I have x to the 6 plus 7, and that's going to give me x to the 13th, and I'm done. I probably wouldn't even have needed to do that step, but I'm showing you so that you can see what the next step, how we get to the answer. But once you see that they're multiplied together, you just need to add those exponents. Really a great rule to remember. It saves you a lot of time. And then I really like those exponent rules. I can't wait to do more of them, but I see that you've got some already planned over there. So
a little inch higher level, yeah, where we can have not just one symbol, but two, A and B. Not just one variable, but two, A and B. If we learn more rules according to what Tammy just explained, we're going to expand to what she just did and make it a little bit, I would say, algebra 1 level or algebra 2 level. Here is one to do, and that is quantity, A to the 5th, B to the 3rd, all to the 4th power. And yes, I want you to learn how to read math. To shine in your class and become the math star guy or lady, you would want to read properly to impress your teacher. And I am so heavy in my classes about reading the math properly. I would not compromise reading the math. I would want always my students to read it properly and 100% properly. And I want you also to do it the way I expect you to do it. Here, when you open this parenthesis, you don't say parenthesis. No, say it the right way. Quantity, A to the 5th power, B to the 3rd power, all. Yes, when you close, you don't say parenthesis. You say all, A-L-L, to the power 4. What happens? Well, we have this exterior power is going to distribute fairly over each one of these. So this is going to become like this, like A to the 5th power, enjoying the power 4 by itself, and this would become like b to the 3rd power, enjoying the power 4 by itself. And as I explained earlier, we have to multiply this by this. So this becomes a to the power 20. Where do you get 20, Hannah? I say, well, 4 times 5 is 20. And that is b to the power 12. Where do you get 12? It's 4 times 3. Do I have to have this step? Well, not really. We can go straight from this to this, and we will be okay. The way we present it here is just for you to learn how it works, but if you can go straight from here to here, you're going to be good. This one. Let's do this the fast track. Skip this step. So the 3 is going to distribute over this and over this and also over this. Yeah, we should not ignore the 2. The 2 as a coefficient would take the power 3 as well. So this would become 2 to the power 3. What's 2 to the power 3? It's 2 times 2 times 2. So that's, I heard somebody said 6. I heard it. That's not right. Common mistake? Yes, it is. Don't do it.
Oops.
Yeah, see? 2 to the power 3, everybody, is about 2 times 2 times 2, 3 times. Not 2 times 3, as many, not many, but few people do.
Oh, no!
Yes, it's 2 to the power 3, everybody. That's 2 to the power 3 means 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8. Because 2 times 2 is 4, and 4 times 2 again is 8. B to the power 7, all to the power 3, multiply 3 by 7, you get B to the power 21. C to the power 4, all to the power 3, would be C to the power 4 times 3 is 12. Find that answer, everybody. Find the answer here for this one. This is find the answer. We skipped the middle step, and we are proud to be able to do it the right way like this. What about this? This involves some division, simplification. To simplify this one, you start by saying, well, what are the coefficients here? 10 is a coefficient of the numerator, 5 is a coefficient of the denominator. Let me get those coefficients taken care of first. 10 divided by 5, everybody, is 2. Then I have A here as a base, A here as a base. I unite these together with 1A. Then I do subtract the exponents. 3 take away 1. You say, where is that 1? I don't see 1 here, Hanna. Are you making up stuff? No, I'm not making stuff up. I'm just realizing that the exponent is 1, even if it is not written. 3 take away 1, everybody, is 2. See? B to the power 8 to the, divided by B to the power 6, you subtract. 8 take away 6, and that is 2. The piece where many people would do wrong here is this piece here. People would wonder if this is 8 to the power 0 or what. No, it's 8 to the power 1. We don't write it. We're writing here for explanation only, but usually we don't write it. And when we don't have the power written, it doesn't mean that it does not have a power. It has a power of 1. 3 minus 1, everybody, is 2. 8 minus 6 is 2. Keep the base once written here once, and B is also written once. And this is how your final answer is for this expression. Right? Oh, that's a mighty one. All right. I like that.
All right, here we go. We're going to take a look at exponents, and this is going to be a really good problem for you to look at. Comes up a lot where we put groups of the numbers together and numbers and letters together, but then, well, even though we have them together, we then multiply it by another group and maybe another group. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of break this down for you so that when you see the word simplify, it means that I want to go ahead and see if I can multiply anything through and get this into a simpler form. So I'm going to use blue for the numbers because remember we have to put the things that are like together so that we can get our number. So all of these are multiplied together. This is multiplied by the second term, the second group, and this is multiplied by this one. So when we go here, we go 8 times 5 times 4. So you're actually going to, on the blue part, do 8 times 5 times 4. So when we multiply that together, we get 160. So I'm going to go step by step. So now you can see that all I've done is look at the numbers. I'm going to grab another color. The next letter that I see is A. And this is an important thing in mathematics. Mathematicians tend to like things in order. So you'll notice that when I finish my answer, I want to make sure it is an A, B, C. So if you happen to get one of these where you don't have an A, a B, and a C, or they're out of order, when you get to your final answer, we typically automatically move them so that they are in numerical order. So let's take a look at the A squared, the A, and as Hanna just told us, don't forget that that's a 1 there. We don't put that because when it's not there, we go ahead and say to ourselves, well, I know that's to the first power. And then I have A to the third. So follow my green. And I'm going to go ahead and put a time sign because all this is multiplied together, but I now have a squared times a times a to the third. What I do now is I remember that one, and I'm finding out what is all of this together. Remember, when we're multiplying like this, we don't expand it out. We can use that rule of adding our exponents. So 2 plus 1 is 3, 3 plus 3 is 6. So this part would be a to the 6th power. That's the green. I'm going to switch to red, and we're going to do the b, b, and b. So here we go. I've got a b, move it a little faster now. I think you're getting it. And these are all to the first power. We don't have to write that. I'm doing that to help us out in our thinking. So this would be b to the third power, 1 plus 1 plus 1. And then the last one, fortunately, I have one more color, and we're going to take a look at the c, this c, and that c. So this would be c to the fourth times c to the sixth times c, and don't forget to put the 1 if you're still making sure you have that in your head. I would also encourage you, if you're working on something, even if you already know that it's a 1, because you're going to be adding, you might want to put the 1 so you don't forget to add it. It's not because I don't think you would know what it was, but I would probably say to myself, let me go ahead and put the 1 so I don't forget to include it in my answer. All right, let's do it. So then we're going to go C, and then we're going to add 4 plus 6 is 10 plus 1 is 11, and then I have now completed all that multiplication just by breaking it down into parts. So I know often sometimes on tests we want to hurry and we want to just go, okay, I think I got all my fours. You might want to take this little step, especially if you're getting ready for your semester exams or you're preparing for the EOCs or something like that. Take a minute to just double check it and make sure you have it. I love doing those kind of problems, not just because I like colors, but because I like math too. So it's a fun problem to do. Hannah, you look like you're ready.
I am.
But Hannah, you know what? I'm a little bit sad again this week because it looks
me
like
too.
the challenge question's on your board.
Yeah, and that's not good news, everybody. I expected you to prove me wrong and come up with the right answer. It's not that hard. You're gonna see how simple it is to do. You just forgot how to do little tiny things, but we're gonna work it together and show you how simple it is to do. And I'm very positive that some of you did it right and could not get through the phone lines. Sometimes they get so hard to find a line to go through it. Here is the quantity, 25% of 40, all raised to the power, quantity 10% of 30, all. I say, well, Hannah, you have to figure out what's that base equal to, and then what's this exponent equal to, and then do your exponents part. So it's a real combination between or of two topics. The percent topic that we covered about a week ago or 2 weeks ago, and then the exponent topic which we're covering today. I have to take this piece separate, work it out, prepare it, take this piece separate, work it out, prepare it, and then take the final base and the final exponent and do my exponent business in the end. Everybody, let's go. 25% of 40 is what? That's my question here. You remember the is over of equals the percent over 100. This is the golden piece that we shared with you the last week or the week before last. This is about is over of equals percent over 100. This is the one we use always to find either the number with the is or with the of or the percent itself. Any of these three, when it is missing, we can figure it out knowing the other two. And with this golden piece here. So let's see what's missing here. 25%, that is the percent part. Here's 25%. Over 100, that's not going to change. The 100 would never change. Equal. What do I have here? Is. Where is the number with is? Is what? So that's the x here. Here is x. The is number is missing. of 40. Okay, 40 of 40 means the 40 is the of number that goes in the denominator. And by cross multiplying and doing the cross multiply, find the value of x. You go x times 100, which is 100x, equals 40 times 25. No, I'm not going to use a calculator still. I can show you how we can do it, mental math. 4 times 25, everybody, is 100, with an extra zero. Here's the 100. 4 times 25 is 100. Then, with the extra zero goes here, that's an extra zero. So it's actually 1,000. 4 times 25 is 100, but 40 times 25 is 1,000. Now I would divide both sides by 100. By 100. When I divide 1,000 by 100, guess what? Those two zeros cross out with these two zeros, and you get with x equal 10. Good news. We have our base taken care of. Now we're going to take the 10% of 30 as an exponent and handle it separate here. 10% of 30. Again, the is over of equals percent over 100. Let's see, 10%, yes, that's the 10 here. That's the percent over 100. It's not going to change. Equals, where is the is number? 10% of 30 is what? So is what, that's where the x is, of 30. So the 30 is the of number, so 30 goes here. Cross multiply, everybody. You get 100x, that's 100 times x is 100x, equal 30 times 10. When you multiply 30 by 10, you get 3 times 1 is 3, and the two zeros go. So it becomes a 300, and here is 100x. You divide both sides by 100, and guess what? When you divide 300 by 100, you get 3 over 1, which is 3, and that's the value of x here. So what do I have to finalize my calculation? To go into this here and find it, we say, we'll say this is equal to, the base is 10, that's the base here, 10. The exponent is the 3, so it's 10 to the power 3. What is 10 to the power 3? We also call it 10 cube, and I will explain to you if we have a minute why we call it 10 cube, and why we call the second power square. 10 cube means 10 times by itself, 3 times, not 30, it's not 10 times 3, everybody. It's 10 times by itself, 3 times. 10 times 10 is 100, 100 times 10 is 1,000. So 1,000 ended being the final result for our challenge question tonight, and see how simple it is. It's long, yet easy to do. Combine two topics in one question. And that was my purpose, to get you to review percentages. As we're getting closer to the midterm, we're trying to get you to do multi-task problems where we can cover more than one topic in each question we can. All right? Now, we're going to pass it on to Tammy, and then we're going to get later on with that cube thing. Why we call 10 to the power 3 10 cube? We're going to talk about this in a minute.
Yeah, that'll be good, because I'm going to actually use something to the third power, so you can kind of talk about that
Sure.
right after we finish. That's going to be really good. Okay, let's take a look at what I have planned right here. I have 2x raised to the third power. Notice these parentheses, and then I have 4y to the third power. I kind of wanted to, in this particular segment, show you how to think through this, because there's two ways to think about what we're doing. So because this is inside the parentheses, this is meaning the same thing as 2x times 2x times 2x. That's the same thing. It's saying multiply this base how many times, and the base happens to be 2x. So when we go through, we could then multiply this out and say 2 times 2 is 4, 4 times 2 is 8, and then remember, we add those exponents, so we would get x to the third power. So that is one method of doing it. On this second one, I want to show you that you could also break this down because they are multiplied together, and you can distribute that 3 as Hannah did on some of the other questions before. So when I take a look at it this way, I would say to myself, this is 4 to the third power times y to the third power, which would then give me 4 times 4 is 16, and 16 times 4, I believe, is 64.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to get y to the third power, use my mental math skills there, love it. And then I end up with the y to the third. So you can see either way I did this, I would end up with the same result, because this would have been 4y times 4y times 4y, which you can see would have been 4 times 4 is 16, 16 times 4 is 64, and then we would have ended up with the same result. So it depends on what your thinking is when you see this. Do you want to expand it out so you can make sure you get them all? Or do you want to remember that you could treat these as two separate pieces, 2 to the third and x to the third, and then you get to the same answer. Just a different way of thinking about the problem and gets to the same result. All right, Hannah, it looks like you're going to have time to share a little bit about the square and the cube.
Mm-hmm. Yes, because we should understand why we say things the way we say them. Okay, this is part of being a master of mathematics. It doesn't mean any other than just knowing exactly what you're saying and what you're doing. So when you do it with confidence. It's not just to be like a machine repeating things without the full understanding and the full sense of it. Here's why we say second power as squared. Watch. Because of the fact, when I get the area of a square, this is a square, and this is a cube. When I get the area of a square, the square is known to have all sides congruent, means of the same length. So if I have a 7 here, this would be a 7. If I have a 10 here, this would be a 10. If I have 17 here, this would be a 17. Whatever length this side has, all these sides would be of the same exact length. So look at its area then. The area here would be base times height, right? So it would be 7 times 7, which is 7 to the power 2, and that's 7 times 7, 7 to the power 2. Remember, this 7 to the power 1, power 1, add 1 plus 1 is 2. 7 power 2. And because this 7 power 2 gave us the area of the square whose length of side is 7, we started then to name this 7 squared. You see, everybody? What about this, Hannah? I say, well, this is almost the same thing except for 3 times. When I have a cube, the cube is known to have all its edges being the same. All of these edges, everybody, are congruent. You can mark these marks all over the cube edges. All of them have the same marking. That is to show us how these 12 edges here are congruent. Whatever this length is, this is the same, this is the same, this is the same. All of the edges are exactly the same. And this is what this is what makes the cube so special and so unique. Okay? So if this is 8, no, so forget about 8, because 8 is a cube by itself. If this is, say, 10 inches, 10 centimeters, and 10 feet, 10 yards, 10 whatever unit, this would be 10, this would be 10. When I get the volume of the cube is length times width times height. The length is what? Is 10. The width is what? Is 10. The height is what? Is also 10. And you find yourself writing 10 times 10 times 10. Based on what Tammy taught us a while ago, when we multiply these, bases are the same, so I put this base once there, and then I add 1 plus 1 plus 1 is 3. You don't have to write those ones every time, but I'm just explaining. And this is 10 cubed, which is 10 cubed. Before I expand the 10 cubed into 1,000, and before I expanded this into a 49, we just stopped here to make sense of the word 7 squared, And we're going to stop here and make sense of the word 10 cubed. Why we call it 10 to the power 3, 10 cubed? Because it gives the volume of a cube whose length of edge 10. All right, everybody? So this is the reason behind calling any number to power 2, that number squared. And this is the reason behind calling any number to the power 3, that number cubed. Hope you enjoyed it. And please, tell your friends about what you know of these terminologies. Maybe they don't know. And you would be a good steward helping them out. All right? Back to you, Tammy.
All right. Thanks, Hanna. I want to make sure that we address a situation that sometimes happens when we're working with our exponents. Because most of the ones that Hanna and I did had an X in both parts that we were working with, so you knew right what to do with those exponents. So let's take a look at what I have right here. Nice problem. Looks like something that I did similar, but I'm going to have to see what happens when I get to the end. So I have an x to the third and an x to the fourth. Well, we've already learned that these are multiplied, so things look good. And we're going to go x to the third times x to the fourth. And in blue, you're going to see me add those exponents, and I'm going to get the 7, because the 3 plus the 4 is 7. Now watch what happens when I move over to my y. So far, so good. I've got my y's and I'm in good shape. I have y to the 4, and we've learned now through the show that we don't need the 1, but we're going to put it there. And we have y to the 5th. Well, here's where I see a common error with students. They all of a sudden get to the z, and let me go ahead and grab a different color. I'm going to do red. They get to the z, and then they come over here and go, what do I do now, right? There's no z there. Well, that's okay, because you can remember that there's always like a 1 can be multiplied by anything. So you could think of this as being z squared times 1 if you need to, but really you're just multiplying it by z squared. So it's a very, I'm going to go ahead and put a line in there, because sometimes we do that in math, so we know it's not a 2. That's one of the things that you learn when you get in higher level mathematics, is that you want to make sure that your z's and your 2's don't look the same. It really, really makes a difference.
And here, Tammy, I'm going to expand on that z to the power 2, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
We're going to talk about how z to the power 2 times that 1 remained z to the power 2. Tammy put that 1, she was a bit in a rush. She did not have a chance to kind of like explain to you why she put 1. The 1 here, everybody, is because I can put this z to the power 2, yes, as is, and I can make this z to the power 0. Mm-hmm. Because z to the power 0 is none other than 1. Yes, it's equal to 1. Yet, it would encourage me to do the rule that we learned. Write the z as a base once, and then add 2 plus 0 is 2. This is how z to the power 2 times 1 is the same as z squared. And it came from the fact that this 1 is none other than a representative of z to the power 0. And by the way, this 1 could be a to the power 0, b to the power 0, c to the power 0, 100 to the power 0. Whatever base we need to adjust with, you can put that base to the power 0. Any a to the power 0, everybody, equal 1, except 0. A cannot be 0. 0 to the power 1, 0 to the power 0, everybody, is the one value, one of the values that scientists have not reached a solution for yet. They don't know what it is yet, and we don't know what it is yet. So we're going to leave it there. A to the power 0 is 1, no matter what that A is, except for 0. Remember that. We're going to say goodnight and see you next time.
Everyone.